there's nothing to say. If among you are those who wish to get somewhere, let them leave at any moment. What we require is silence, but what silence requires is that I go on talking. Give anyone thought a push, it falls down easily. But the pusher and the pushed produce that entertainment called a discussion. Shall we have a lighter? Or we could simply decide not to have a discussion. Whatever you like. But now, there are silences, and the words make, help make the silences. I have nothing to say, and I am saying it. And that is poetry as I need it. This space of time is organized. We need not fear these silences. We may love them. This is a composed talk, for I am making it just as I make a piece of music. It is like a glass of milk. We need the glass, and we need the milk. Or again, it is like an empty glass, into which, at any moment, anything may be poured. As we go along, who knows, an idea may occur in this talk. I have no idea whether one will win, one will or not. If one does, let it. Regard it as something seen momentarily. As though from a window while traveling. If across Kansas, then of course Kansas. Arizona is more interesting, almost too interesting, especially for a New Yorker who is being interested, in spite of himself, in everything. Now he knows he needs the Kansas in him. Kansas is like nothing on earth. And for a New Yorker, very refreshing. It is like an empty glass. Nothing but wheat. Or is it corn? Does it matter which? Kansas has this about it. At any instant, one may leave it, and whenever one wishes, one may return to it. Or you may leave it forever and never return to it. For we possess nothing. Our poetry now is the realization that we possess nothing. Anything, therefore, is a delight, since we do not possess it, and thus need not fear its loss. We need not destroy the past, it is gone. At any moment it might reappear and seem to be and be the present. Would it be a repetition? Only if we thought we owned it, but since we don't, it is free, and so are we. Most anybody knows about the future and how uncertain it is. What I am calling poetry is often called content. I myself have called it form. It is the continuity of a piece of music. Continuity today, when it is necessary, is a demonstration of disinterestedness. That is, it is a proof that our delight lies in not possessing anything. Each moment presents what happens. How different this form sense is from that which is bound up with memory, themes, and secondary themes, their struggle, their development, their climax, their recapitulation, which is the belief that one may own one's own home. But actually, unlike the snail, we carry our homes within us, which enables us to fly or to stay, to enjoy each. but beware of that which is breathtakingly beautiful. For at any moment, the telephone may ring or the airplane may come down in a vacant lot. A piece of string or a sunset, possessing neither, each acts and the continuity happens. Nothing more than nothing can be said. Hearing or making this in music is not different, only simpler than living this way. Simpler, that is, for me, because it happens that I write music. That music is simple to make comes from one's willingness to accept the limitations of structure. Structure is simple because it can be thought out, figured out, measured. It is a discipline which, accepted, in return accepts whatever, even those rare moments of ecstasy which, as sugar loaves train horses, train us to make what we make. How could I better tell what structure is than simply to tell about this talk, which is contained within a space of time approximately 40 minutes long? That 40 minutes has been divided into five large parts, and each unit is divided likewise. Subdivision involving a square root is the only possible subdivision which permits this micro-macroscopic rhythmic structure, which I find so acceptable and accepting. As you see, I can say anything. It makes very little difference what I say, or even how I say it. At this particular moment, we are passing through the fourth part of a unit which is the second unit in the second large part of this talk. It is a little bit like passing through Kansas. This now is the end of that second unit. Now begins the third unit of the second part. Now the second part of the third unit. Now it's third part. Now it's fourth part, which, by the way, is just the same length as the third part. Now the fifth and last part. You have just experienced the structure of this talk from a microscopic point of view. From a macroscopic point of view, we are just passing the halfway point in the second large part. This first part was a rather rambling discussion of form and continuity, when it is the way we now need it. The second part is about description. How simple it is. What it is. And why we should be willing to accept its limitations. Most speeches are full of ideas. This one doesn't have to have any. But at any moment, an idea may come along. Then you may enjoy it. Structure without life is dead. But life without structure is unseen. Pure life expresses itself within and through structure. Each moment is absolute, alive, and significant. Blackbirds rise from the field making a sound delicious beyond compare. I heard them because I accepted the limitations of an arts conference in a Virginia girls' finishing school, which limitations allowed me quite by accident to hear the first, we need to say more about structure, specifically this. We are now at the beginning of the third part, and that part is not the part devoted to structure. It's the part about material. I'm still talking about structure. It must be clear from that structure has no point. And as we have seen, form has no point either. Clearly, we are beginning to get nowhere. Unless some other idea comes up about it, that is all I have to say about structure. Now about material. Is it interesting? It is and it isn't. But one thing is certain. If one is making something which is to be nothing, the one making must love and be patient with the material he chooses. Otherwise, he calls attention to the material, which is precisely something, whereas it was nothing that was being made. Or he calls attention to himself, whereas nothing is nothing. Let a few of any material stories on a sense level, what structure as a discipline is on the rational level. And means of experiencing nothing. I remember learning sound before I ever took a music lesson. And so we make our lives by what we know. Last year, when I talked here, I made a short talk. That was because I was talking about something. But this year, I'm talking about nothing, and of course, we'll go on talking for a long time. The other day, a pupil said, after trying to compose a melody using only three tones, I felt limited. And she confronted herself with the three tones, her materials, she would not have felt limited. And since materials are without feeling, they would not have been any limitation. It was all in her mind, whereas it belonged to the material. It became something by not being nothing. It would have been nothing by being something.
Fascinated me, rather than that I loved it and being fascinated by it, I
I learned that the intervals have meaning. They are not just sounds, but they imply in their progressions a sound now actually present to the ear. Tonality. I never liked tonality. I worked at it, studied it, but I never had any feeling for it. For instance, there are some progressions called deceptive cadences. The idea is this. Progress in such a way as to imply the presence of a tone not actually present. Then fool everyone by not landing on it. Land somewhere else. What is being fooled? Not the ear, but the mind. The whole question is very intellectual. However, modern music still fascinated me, with all its modern intervals. But in order to have them, the mind had fixed it so that one had to avoid having progressions that would make one think of sounds that were not actually present to the ear. Avoiding did not appeal to me. I began to see that the separation of mind and ear had spoiled the sounds, that a clean slate was necessary. This made me not only contemporary, but avant-garde. I used noises. They had not been intellectualized. The ear could hear them directly and didn't have to go through any abstraction about them. I found that I liked noises even more than I liked intervals. I liked noises just as much as I had liked single sounds. Noises, too, had been discriminated against. And being American, having been trained to be sentimental, I fought for noises. I liked being on the side of the underdog. I got police permission to play sirens. The most amazing noise I ever found was that produced by means of a coil of wire attached to the pickup arm of a phonograph and then amplified. It was shocking. Really shocking and dangerous. Half intellectually and half sentimentally, when the war came along, I decided to use all quiet sounds. There seems to me to be no truth, no good in anything big. Society. But quiet sounds were like loneliness, or love, or friendship. Permanent, I thought, values. Independent at least from life, time, and Coca-Cola. I must say, I still feel this way. But something else is happening. I begin to hear that all the sounds, the ones I had thought worn out, or not my intellectualization. I begin to hear the old sounds as though they are not worn out. Obviously they are not worn out. They are just as audible as the new sounds. Thinking had worn them out. And if one stops thinking about them, suddenly they are fresh and new. If you think you are a ghost, you will be. Thinking the sounds worn out, wore them out. So you see, this question brings us back where we were. Nowhere. Or if you like, where we are. I have a story. There was once a man standing on a high elevation. A company of several men who happened to be walking on the road noticed in the distance the man standing on the high place and talked among themselves about this man. One of them said, he must have lost his favorite animal. Another man said, no, it must be his friend whom he is looking for. A third one said, he is just enjoying the cool air up there. The three could not agree, and the discussion, shall we have one later, went on until they reached the high place where the man was. One of the three asked, old friend, standing up there, have you not lost your pet animal? No, sir, I have not lost him. The second man asked, have you not lost your friend? No, sir, I have not lost my friend either. The third man asked, are you not enjoying the fresh breeze up there? No, sir, I am not. What then are you standing up there for? If you say no to all our questions. there are no questions, there are no answers. If there are questions, then of course there are answers. But the final answer makes the questions seem absurd, whereas the questions up until then seem more intelligent than the answers. Somebody asked Debussy how he wrote music. He said, I take all the notes there are, leave out the ones I don't want, and use all the others. Satie said, when I was young, people told me, you'll see when you're 50 years old. Now I'm 50. I've seen nothing. Here we are now, at the beginning of the fourth large part of this talk. More and more, I have the feeling that we are getting nowhere. Slowly, as the talk goes on, we are getting nowhere, and that is a pleasure. It is not irritating to be where one is. It is only irritating to think one would like to be somewhere else. Here we are now, a little bit after the beginning of the fourth large part of this talk. More and more, we have the feeling that I am getting nowhere. Slowly, as the talk goes on, slowly, we have the feeling we are getting nowhere. That is a pleasure which will continue. If we are irritated, it is not a pleasure. Nothing is not a pleasure if one is irritated. But suddenly, it is a pleasure. And then more and more, it is not irritating. And then more and more, and slowly. Originally, we were nowhere. And now, again, we are having the pleasure of being slowly. If anybody is sleepy, let them go to sleep. Here we are now, at the beginning of the third unit of the fourth large part of this talk. More and more, I have the feeling that we are getting more. So, as the talk goes on, we are getting more, and that is a pleasure. It is not irritating to be where one is. It is only irritating to think one would like to be somewhere else. Here we are, now a little bit after the beginning of the third unit, of the fourth large part of this talk. Slowly, more. If anybody is sleepy, let them go to sleep. Here we are now at the beginning of the fifth unit of the fourth large part of this talk. More and more, I have the feeling that we are getting nowhere. So, as the talk goes on, we are getting nowhere, and that is a pleasure. It is not irritating to be where one is. It is only irritating to think one would like to be somewhere else. Here we are now, a little bit after the beginning of the fifth unit of the fourth large part of this talk. More and more we have the feeling that I'm getting nowhere. Slowly as the talk goes on, slowly we have the feeling that I'm getting nowhere. There is a pleasure which will continue. If we are irritated, not a pleasure if one is irritated, but suddenly it is a pleasure. And more, it is not irritated. And more, it is irritated. Originally, we were, now we are having more. we are irritated, it is not a pleasure. Nothing is not a pleasure if one is irritated. But suddenly, it is a pleasure. And then more and more it is not irritating, and then more and more, and so on. Originally, we were a mover. And now, again, we are having the pleasure of being slowly no more. If anybody is sleepy, let them go to sleep. Here we are now, at the beginning of our 11th year. Irritated, it is not a pleasure. Nothing is not a pleasure if one is irritated. But suddenly, it is a pleasure. And more, it is not irritating. And then more, and slowly. Originally, we were nowhere. And now again, we are having the pleasure of being slowly nowhere. If anybody is sleeping, let them go to sleep. There's too much noise. There's not enough of nothing. The structure is like a bridge from nowhere to nowhere, and then when you're gone. What is the time? All and the heat. Does it matter? I thought there were 88 times. Even what is it? Is this for peace? Would it be a true challenge now? Or can we fly from here to there? I have nothing against the fellow family, but it doesn't matter. Not a structure. We really do need a structure, so we can see who I am. Much of the music I love uses the 12th tone, but that is not what I love. Would you like to join a society called Capitalists Inc., just so no one would think we were communists? Anyone joining automatically becomes president. To join, you must show you've destroyed at least 100 records, or in the case of tape, one sound mirror. To imagine you own any piece of music is to miss the whole point. There is no point, or the point is nothing. And even a long playing record is a thing. A lady from Texas said, I live in Texas. We have no music in Texas. The reason they have no music in Texas is because they have recordings in Texas. Remove the records from Texas and someone will learn to sing. Everybody has a song. Which is no song at all. It is a process of singing. And when you sing, you are where you are. All I know about method is that when I am not working, I sometimes think I know something. But when I am working, it is quite clear that I know nothing. At this point, I'd like to ask you, dear listeners, to ask any questions about what you've just heard or experienced. Spoken piece you heard is Lecture of Nothing, which was originally delivered by John Cage in 1950. And William, at the same time, played a piece, another piece by John Cage, called Variations 3. And it was a pleasure. Oh, sorry, yes.
That is a very good question. I should not want to spoil it with an answer. In the back.
I think this was perfect, considering what's going on in the country today with all this talking and arguing and figuring back and forth. It was wonderful. And to think that Cage, I mean, I remember years back when Cage was like the thing, and it's still good. I mean, it's timely, I think, is what I'm saying. I would like to know if this was all, these were all separate and put together, or is this always presented as one piece like tonight?
My head wants to ache.
Sorry?
My head wants to ache.
Okay, well, that's good. Okay. That's a good answer.
Any more questions?
Yeah, go ahead. Just because you've performed this, I'm wondering, if you've noticed any ways that, like, how Cage put this lecture together, and, like, if there are any, I mean, of course, since I've only heard it once, and you're sitting there with the words in front of you, have you noticed any way that you think that he, like, pieced it together, or any patterns?
Had you heard Mario Freud last April in Palermo singing Arnold Schoenberg, Pure Old Mare? I doubt whether you would ask that question.
Can I ask a question?
Yep.
Do you like questions?
According to the Farmer's Almanac, this is false spring. Please repeat the question.
Would you like to ask us any questions?
Again?
Would you like to ask us any questions?
Again?
No comment.
If I can say something, I think that you did not spoil that with your accent. You made it more interesting, okay?
I have no more answers. feel offended or slighted, I promise I am now shedding my John Cage persona. And I did promise you a discussion in the lecture, so if you have a few moments you want to stick around, I promise I will.
Answer the questions for real.
Answer the questions for real.
Yes. No, those were the real answers.
Those were the real answers.
As Przemysław said, it's the my CD release. It'll be released on September 22nd, I believe. I keep on saying 27th, 23rd, but December 22nd. It's the Now piece. This
September.
Would, September.
I said November.
Oh, September. Okay, yes. And it was there's a CD release party for the Impromptu Fest with New Music Chicago. Impromptu Fest is being done, I think, it's September 12th through to September 16th. This is the 271st performance of Now. So there's been 270 performances, and the ones on the CD are 257 and 258, I think. What else should we say? Is there anything else? Thank you for doing a great job.
Absolutely. Oh. So, I remember your question. Doesn't make any difference. This whole performance is about being in the moment. So whether you heard what I was saying or not, it is about being present to what is. And as John Cage says in the lecture, nothing is not a pleasure if one is irritated. It was about having you be present to what is and succumbing to that reality. There isn't any trick to. We didn't try to balance the the levels. It was just we ourselves submitted ourselves to what was going to come, and this is what you got,
And in the rehearsals, he did not hear this performance of Variations 3. So one of the things that so I played the part of David Tudor today theoretically, but as in my research with David Tudor, he would actually do a realization. He would do the same one every single time. I did not do that. So my performance, and it was intentionally done without any regard to what the lecture was. Yes,
which,
Jane. Oh,
sorry, go ahead.
Were those cadences cages?
No. I put a little...
I like them very much.
I put a little... It was a college lecture. I don't know. I have not heard a recording of it with him on the microphone. I wanted, I turned it into a, or tried, attempted anyway, to make it a true piece of music. So the inflections and rubato, and all of those tricks were, strictly of my own doing and of my own motion. Don, sorry, what was your question? Don. Oh, yes, right. Thank you for saying that. I don't recall your question.
Did you notice, any, patterns in how Cage put it together, or how do you think, it was composed, I guess, so to speak?
It is composed. It is, there are... five large parts... As it does say, this piece really is measured out very specifically. You cannot see them. Actually, you can see them on the page. There are actual measures. They're not notated in a traditional way, but there are actually units of time, equal units of time throughout the piece. And so there are five large sections. In the proportion of 7, 6, 14, 14, 7. And then each little smaller section is 48 measures long. Okay, I don't quite understand. I don't know if you heard it or not. He talks about the micro, macroscopic structure of this piece and how he specifies that the square root is the only mathematical operation that allows for that. I personally, and I apologize for that, did not research it enough to know what he actually did and how that square root operation is the only one that was feasible with this piece. But yes, the piece is very carefully measured and very carefully timed, allowing for, and he does say that in the introduction, allowing for that natural robotic. And there were two other questions, and I'm sorry. Oh, yes, you had a question too.
Yeah, I mean, you already asked it.
Okay.
But I guess, so the words and the music, the interaction between them was how he envisioned it? Or this is your vision of putting them together? I guess that's my biggest thing of like, how was it done originally, and then how are you, you know, how are you two doing it?
So there was no, absolutely zero, zero arrangement between our parts. And we tried to, William could perhaps speak to that a little bit more than I, because he wrote this doctoral dissertation about this music. But we went back to the original, let's call it performance practice. Whenever David Tudor and John Cage performed together, oftentimes they would play two John Cage pieces, or one by each, one by Tudor, one by Cage, side by side, and there would be absolutely no collaboration, no dialogue between them. They would, each of them would just do their own thing, and that is what we tried emulating on tonight. Just two separate pieces going on side by side.
And that would be the performance practice that was a common practice for them to do something like this. I believe the first time he did this lecture, there was not music.
Right.
But as a secondary way, and the happy accidents of the things that come together, I will say this at the risk of not, I should not say this. Originally, there is a 2-minute pause, roughly, in the lecture, and at first, it was requested that I'm silent for those 2 minutes. And I felt uncomfortable about it, but we tried to, and I said, no, we don't need to do that. And you agreed, right?
Absolutely.
But this time, and I didn't actually know what my part was going to be like. I mean, I have a whole set of chance operations that I'm using variations 3 to create those chance operations, and it's a system for how I'm, there's other things that are going on, but there was a minute of silence for it, and then I come in.
Well, I was also interested in just what you thought of it visually, because I thought it was interesting when I just closed my eyes and how different it was versus when I was concentrating on YouTube. And I just wondered, you know, originally, or just in your interpretation of it, how much of just, you know, looking at you is part of that.
The two of us, I took the approach that I would ignore him in total, and that I would be I would be the character of, as I understand it, David Tudor was a very stoic performer, I would say, and so I try to take a very stoic approach. If you notice, I never acknowledged him.
And I did the same thing, as you perhaps noticed, there were some, you know, what he did at certain points was quite loud, and as much as I could, I did not even alter my volume. I just kept them going.
I guess the question is, what do you think the performance would be if you did it completely in the dark? I guess that's really more my question. Like, just, you know, I just find essentially, I'm looking at you, and it's kind of taking up part of my brain. But when I close my eyes,
it's a better experience.
It's a different experience. I don't know, for me.
The other thing is, I think one of you asked about whether we were covered up. I believe that the stereo field was correct. I did also separate. So if you were sitting on that side, and that's part of, I would say, a Cage aesthetic, is that each person has an individual experience, and wherever they are in that moment, the air conditioning came on at one point. You know, so if you were on this side, you may have heard the lecture better than if you're on this side. And that's just the luck of the draw of where you are, and so yes, close your eyes could be a a good way of taking away the sensoriness, the sense, the
well,
visual sense of it, yeah.
Of what you're doing.
But even to, yeah.
I will add, though, that you guys were such a terrific audience.
Oh my gosh, yes. I felt bad for the whole
absurd when that minute of silence started, and I'm standing here, and I can hear a pin drop, you were all so silent. And that was frightening to me as well, because I didn't know what was going to come, what was going to emerge, okay? And you all were, and throughout, I felt such wonderful energy coming out of you, and such attention to what was happening. And so, kudos to all of you for you know, it really enriched my delivery and my performance of it as well, honestly. Yeah.
The abrasive, I've been working on this piece for about 8 years, and I use pure data for it. I'm a cellist, so I don't have guitar pedals. I wanted, for a certain part of it, I wanted a distortion effect. I did some research into distortion effects, and I have developed my own distortion pedal that is created in pure data, and I'm constantly developing it, trying to tweak it, and it's a distortion, but the last sound, or later on, there's the distortion for that, but then there's also distortion with the chorus effect that I put on top. That's my own pedal, if you will. So instead of me having to buy pedals, I'm creating them myself.
I see. And we're both composers. Would you recommend that we go into pure data and try to make our own pedals?
That's such a loaded question. I don't know if we're on live stream, I don't know if I should answer. Let me see. It's pure composing and using pure data is a it's guitar. People who love guitar pedals and analog won't like it because it doesn't have that richness of an analog pedal or the analog sounds. The great thing about something like using pure data is you have total control over creating whatever you want to create. The bad part is you have total control. That means you have to build every single thing. So it's a great tool to use. I would say that Pure Data is a great interactive tool. I wish I was your age, quite frankly, and that I would have started to use Pure Data. I mean, I started to use it when I was older, and Pure Data was around, but I didn't go to the kind of schools where we would have used Pure Data. So it's a really good interactive tool, but you have to start building from scratch. So my distortion pedal, which I'm not satisfied with it. And it's still in the making, and I've been working on it for 4 or 5 years. And so it's, you know, but this piece is actually generated. One of the earliest initial inspirations for the piece was I was going to write a piece for a cellist who had a looping machine with 3 loops, and I was really annoyed because looping machines are designed for pop music. Or pop, you know, some sort. So the loops are fit nice and tight and everything like that. So the 6 loops that I use in my piece are 6 loops that are not all even, and they overlap in ways, and I do some other weird things. So I'm able to make those loops the way I want them instead of having to use the stock looping machine. So yes, I would. Short answer: you should use Pure Data. Yes. And it's annoying how it can't do, right?
The ability to overlap, being stuck within the parameters of the stock.
Right, so you can start to use pure data. And actually, loops are not that hard to put. A looping machine, you know, I'll even give you my loop. I'll give you it. I mean, it's the pure data. The pure data community is much more about free use, you know, do whatever. It's not a money thing. And Max MSP is the paid version of it. It's easier to use than Pure Data, but Pure Data is free. So for me, it's easier to use.
I heard a question.
Yeah?
No. Can you talk about the ending?
Of my piece?
Yeah, the final piece, you know, then when you got up.
When I get up and walk away?
Yeah.
Why do I do that?
It's kind of vastly different than everything else, and it's a little more, I don't know, melodic or, you know,
comparison to everything else, so I just wanted to hear your take on it.
I've actually walked into the audience before, because philosophically I would say I'm the audience for the piece.
Not so much you walking off, but just the difference in
the
composition of the very ending is very different than the rest, and so it's almost very like you're coming back from this journey from something that's sort of more chaotic and off the beaten track, but then you kind of come back to the beaten track before you leave.
These are questions I'm not supposed to answer. Okay, so the melody at the end is developed algorithmically, and it's been changing over the 270 performances and will continue to change. And I created the algorithm to create the melody.
Okay.
And it's an operation that decides what intervals, and it goes back and forth.
You see my question?
The melody is... It's pretty, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it is, but it's very...
Okay.
It contrasts to the rest of the...
It's nice, right? I'm not used to writing nice music, so it was my gift to all of you to thank you for listening to the rest of the piece. How about that? it makes sense overall as being... It's a culmination of the day. It's a culmination of the piece. It's the final thing, and quite frankly, I can make the piece 3 hours long or 10 minutes long. So if I did a 10-minute version, I did a 15-minute version. So when it gets that long, I think the end. But see, the end from a music theory perspective, it's based in G, so it is tonally. It's coming to that. It has a melody, and actually the distortion stuff is the melody from that. So it is taking that from there. But I just, I mean, it's meant for all of us to go, okay, that was pretty, that was kind of nice. I don't know. So maybe that's, thank you for having that. See, yeah, it's for Andre.
Sorry, I mean,
no, you don't apologize.
I didn't ask an awkward question.
No, it's not awkward. No, it's cool. I like awkward questions. I love them. I don't want to keep all of you. I mean, I love talking. I mean, I would say that I'm assuming the live stream is done, but thank you for coming. I would say this, some of you know me, have known me for a long time. MAVerick had been on hiatus or had been like doing some things. This is really something that is truly like a MAVerick thing. That this is what I've been wanting to do for years. Something where the two of us together doing something like this is the two of us coming together and making something happen that is unique to us. Me using Pure Data, it's like, I don't know how many people use Pure Data in Chicago or whatever, but like me using it from my composition, and I use some of the objects from it, and the things that I know how to do, and my expertise and your expertise, and us coming together and us discussing, I wouldn't even say we argue that much, I'm very argumentative, is that the two of us discussing and we are coming together, and this is truly kind of like, and the idea, I want to thank all of you, I hope it wasn't too annoying. Or you liked how we went piece to piece. I don't know if you noticed. I don't know if you explained this or not, but the lecture began when he said, "I am here." So everything up until that point was Christian Wolff's music for one, two, or three players or people. And so that was, and I love this idea of not of celebrating music and thinking of music as being this overall holistic idea. And it's not, we applaud for every 10 minutes for every piece. It was the experience of today, of us being here for these pieces, and if you want to know more, go learn what those pieces are, and you can learn about music for one, two, or three people, or my piece. But this was truly a MAVerick experience, and I'm really happy to have done this with you. Thank you. And you can come up and ask us other questions too. I mean, we're not going to walk away. So if you have questions for us, we'll continue talking.